colleague will be here a little bit later, but he will kick it out for us in a little bit. Probably some other people will be coming in, but we're just gonna kick it off. Guys, enjoy it. Have a warm welcome for Matt over here.
So it's fun to be able to give a software service event after having attended several of them and given lightning talks at one. So thanks for hosting me, Richard. That's really cool. And I really liked the spirit of software circus events. My idea for today, and I want to also just check this with you guys, was I know that the container solutions and Docker run stuff people I've met are hugely experimental and get their hands on stuff. And they're already using Docker all over the place mostly. So I did not at all want to just do something where we just give a talk and slides. I wanted to do something, actually like I used to do at Amsterdam with you, hands-on, getting people with their hands in the clay, actually using Kubernetes instead of just an abstract talk. So we do have some code labs to walk you guys through today. And of course, if you just want to go off in your own direction, you're welcome to do that, and we'll help out as well as we can. But with so many people, we might need to stick to code lab. I might need to stick to supporting code lab. We do have some slides just to cover the basic concepts, but the goal is not to like kill you with slides, but get the concepts understood before people go running off to do code labs.
Go more closer,
more louder. Okay, I'm not used to microphones. So David Aronchick is the senior Kubernetes product manager, and I will introduce him when he arrives. He's flying in from London, so he was at KubeCon this week in London, and he flew in this morning to join us, except he was had delays at Heathrow. So he just landed 30 minutes ago and is getting in a taxi to come join us as soon as he can. That's okay, I'll lead it for now. What I was thinking to start with was to make sure everybody has a Google Cloud Platform project running, because that's where we'll do the code labs today. Of course, the awesome thing about Kubernetes is you can run it anywhere. So if you prefer to run it in your own cluster, go for it. But we have a fully managed version of Kubernetes where we do the patching and we do the maintenance for you. And you click a button and you've got a cluster running in 2 minutes. So it's sort of, for a code lab getting started stuff, that's kind of attractive. So I'm based out of the Amsterdam office. I've been at Google for 3 years. Before that, I was a software engineer, software lead at a pacemaker company called Medtronic, and later IKEA. And basically I work with our cloud platform customers across Belgium, Netherlands, and Luxembourg. And next to that, I just do a lot of community events, because I think they're much more interesting than going and talking to managers at insurance companies and trying to convince them to use our stuff. It's much more fun working directly with people who are doing it. And I just flew back in from America yesterday, so I'm really tired. I wanted to ask what you guys are doing. So how many people are running any sort of Docker image, any Oracle OS Rocket image in production today? Okay, so a bunch of people running in production. And how many people have built a Docker image just on their own laptop, even if they're not running it in production anymore? Good, so we can maybe skip over what is Docker, that's good. For the people who are running it in production or in test clusters at least, can you shout out where you're running it or what tools you're using to manage your container clusters?
Compose.
Docker Compose, who else? Raise your hands for Docker Compose. Cool, any else, any other big ones? Somebody told me Mesos.
Mesos?
Yeah. Who else is using Mesos? Okay, good. So it's like about 6-7 Docker Compose and 6-7 Mesos. Do you guys have any specific questions you want to cover today? Because I mean, we've got generic code labs. David's going to talk a little bit about what's happening in Kubernetes 1.2, which is kind of nice because then you actually see the roadmap. So any specific questions or curiosity or things that you felt were missing, those would be good. Let's capture them now so we can ask David later. Did you have one?
Sorry.
Well, networking is...
Networking?
Yeah.
So how networking works inside Kubernetes?
Yeah, and inside the get, inside the host.
Yeah. Cool, that'll be good. We'll make sure we cover that at some point today.
Security?
Security, as in security of the Docker image, running containers from different people in the same cluster.
Yeah.
Multiple containers talking to each other and not to something else.
Yeah. So it's also sort of like verified builds, making sure you're not deploying a container that was didn't go through your QAT, your process correctly. Yeah. Okay. That's a good one.
That's good. Yeah, from best practices around.
Yeah, best practices around like operations monitoring or.
Yeah.
So I talked to sometimes to customers about best practices for operations and monitoring. Probably David is better to see like best practices for large clusters, like how can you get them to talk to you together. State. Oh, yeah, that's a good one. I have some slides about that. I know we didn't want to read too much slides, but I do have a couple of slides that just visualize the three different options that I know for having a state. I should have written these down. Network security, best practices, state.
What not to do.
What not to do. Like bad practices. Yeah. Yeah, that's a good idea. I can think of a few things I've heard where people got into trouble already. Yeah. I thought it would be useful to actually have everyone make sure that you just have a project created and sign up for the free trial. That gives you $300 credits, which should be enough to get you through a fair amount of experimentation. Since we're going to be doing the code labs. Like I said, you can do these code labs anywhere you want. Anywhere you can run Kubernetes, you can do these code labs. But they're focused on running in Container Engine today. So that free trial link, you can basically, you do need a Google account of some sort. It is possible to attach a Google account to a non-Gmail address. If you need to do that, let me know. We'll kind of walk through that. I guess if everyone just takes a couple minutes and just makes sure that they've gotten into console.developers.google.com and clicked the Create Project button. Also, just while you're doing that, you know, keep working, but while you're doing that, there's a really nice code lab. I don't think it's the code lab that David's going to go through today, but it's an awesome code lab to kind of explain how to work with our tools, and including Container Engine. And if you're experimenting and having interesting questions, the Slack channel, slack.kubernetes.io, is monitored by like the Google on-call engineers. When whoever's on-call, the site reliability engineer who's responsible for keeping our services up, when there's not fires in the data center that he or she is putting out, they're monitoring that Slack channel. And there's, I think, hundreds of active people from the community and the Google engineers who develop Kubernetes, the Red Hat engineers who contribute to Kubernetes, a bunch of people are monitoring and active on that channel. Just in general, all time, always. So a lot of times when a customer doesn't have paid support, but they have questions, architecture questions, or something's broken, what am I doing wrong, they go to the Slack channel. And it's super active. It's more active than the Stack Overflow.
It's quite hard to build it.
Oh yeah, they're very active here actually. The current practice for that is like for our cloud platform projects. But it's not across 100% of the board, but most like Dataflow, Dataproc, Kubernetes, other things. The engineers on call monitor Stack Overflow and Slack and participate there. So, okay, a couple things. One person noticed you do need a credit card for the free trial. It won't be charged unless you, of course, go over the free trial. So, of course, monitor it. Maybe one of the last things we do today will be to make sure that everyone turns off any resources they're using so they don't continue to build. But basically, if you go to console.developers.google.com and click Create Project, you should be good. Activate the free trial.
This actually, I'm just going to go through the process of setting up a project and enabling Kubernetes, and I'll that way you guys can see how it goes. Two-factor authentication. Okay. You can also search when you search for things. You'll find. Let's create a new presentation. in the console under the create project. Basically, when you sign into the console, there's a lot of different options. So we're going to call this software circuits Kubernetes. Okay, my billing account. You can have different. You can have many different billing accounts. I'm just going to use. I've got a. You can also set where you want the project to run. Kubernetes. I'm going to choose Europe. You have to do that in project creation. Although that only applies to App Engine, the rest of the resources you can decide where you want them to run anytime.
Okay, so I just created a project. And I'm going to actually, I don't remember if I need to turn on the Kubernetes API. Let me just go to the container engine. You can also pin things up on top. I've got container engine pinned on top. And it might be, it's taking a little while because I think I need to activate the container engine API. Just search for container engine and compute engine and make sure those APIs are enabled. Just to make sure, I think everybody probably has this, but just want to go to the API manager, make sure that the compute engine API is enabled. I need to enable it. So when you start a new project, you usually might need to enable the compute engine API. That just lets you launch commands that start virtual machines and stuff. It lets the SDK launch commands that we start with. And also while you're there, probably set up the container engine. Ooh, hey, there's other ones. So enable the container engine API also. Dave, are there other APIs you recommend people enable, like the logging API or anything like that?
Monitoring and logging is always good. Remember, logging is free, monitoring is free, logging is free, unless you query, and then it's just based on the number of queries that you do. It's very, very cheap.
Okay.
Those two will take care of it.
Yeah. So
I'm fairly certain you do that as part of the
code lab
setup. No, as part of the cluster setup, there should be some checkboxes.
Okay, then they'll do it anyway. So, like during the code lab that we run, there will be some other APIs, so just in case we miss some of them, check the code lab. But the cloud monitoring API basically enables Stackdriver for ops and alerts, maybe not something you need today. But cloud logging is also very useful, that all of the logs from your cluster go to a central logging point.
I'm the product manager for Kubernetes and GKE. And Kubernetes and GKE are great, but they really are a little bit down the journey to a running like Google. Like, first thing to start running like Google is run inside a container. Because a container gives you all sorts of isolation and benefits and things like that. So, we know most of you know containers. Obviously, and those who have already started using it in production realize that kind of the next step after you containerize your workloads is, what do I do with it? You have to bring it to production, and then there's a whole set of things. What I'd love to talk to you a little bit about today is some of the concepts involved with Kubernetes before we dive into some of the code lab. The concepts behind containers, the idea that you take an application, you put it into a space, and then you isolate that space, either from a permissions perspective, or resources, or identity, things like that. That's not new. That's been around for 20, 25 years. The folks at Google were the ones who were some of those folks who brought those concepts to Linux. 2004, 2005, they were the ones who did the check-ins. And the reason they did that is because they realized that Google, with the scale and ambition that they had in 2004, needed containers in order to do what they needed to do. And what that is it's to bring portability. It's to develop all these hundreds, thousands, millions of machines out there in the world and be able to move your applications between them in an incredibly easy way. That was the benefit that people saw for containers. At the same time they did that, they realized, well, it's not just bringing your application into a container, it's actually making it production ready. So we're going to have 1,000 machines and we're going to put some of our workload on every one of those 1,000 machines. How do I know which ones keep up? How do I know which ones are still healthy? Where do I aggregate the logs? How do I monitor them on an ongoing basis? How do I have them discover each other? These are all very, very common problems that we solved inside of Google using something called Borg, which the folks wrote about the same time, or started writing anyway. And as a result, here we are 12 years later. Everything at Google runs inside of a container. Every stateful app, every stateless app, every API, every Gmail, every Google search you do, every map, every even storage. We store blobs inside containers through a distributed file system. Even Google Cloud's VMs run inside a container, which then themselves run on top of bare metal. So we are all in on this, and it gives us incredible portability so that if we decide that a certain data center is overloaded, we can literally, you know, bring another one up, pull them down, and move those applications left and right. Or, you know, the better practice is you start a whole new set of applications and you just kill the old ones. And as a result, we launch about 2 billion containers a week. So, as I mentioned before, the difference between building a container, which is awesome, and bringing it to production are the things you see there on the on this screen. You have to know all these different things, no matter what, and it's whether or not it comes with the orchestrator that you use, or you build it yourself. You gotta get the stuff out there, you gotta manage it once it's out there, for example, through updates and health checking and things like that. You gotta make sure to isolate it properly. Service discovery is probably one of the most fundamental problems. I just started a container over here. What do I have to do to have that container that's been running for 20 minutes see it? And then go through things like scaling and replication so that you can actually respond to customers on demand. So that's where Kubernetes comes in. I mentioned about 10, 11 years ago when we first got into containers on Google, we also started writing something called Borg. Borg is our internal way of managing containers. It does all the things that you saw there on that previous slide. In the middle of 2013, when Docker started taking off, we said, hey, we should really open source Borg because we know that people are going to run into the same problems that we've been running into for 10 years, and they're going to want something that solves those problems for them. The problem is that Borg is totally customized for Google data centers. It just doesn't make sense to take it and open source it just the source code. So we took all the concepts that are in Borg and we rewrote them in Go and then released that. But if you produce a Kubernetes YAML at the end of today, an application file that starts your application, and you walked internally to Google and grabbed one of our application files, it looked really, really similar. And that's because all the concepts are the same, and the idea is this is based on what we know. The most important thing on this slide is that middle part. The thing that we've really tried with Kubernetes is to be multi-cloud. We want to support you no matter where you are. Though this started from Google, this is not by any stretch a Google-only project. There are 650 unique contributors to the project, and we only have 50 people at Google who are working on it. So this is a broad thing that is supported by Red Hat and Mesos and IBM and Huawei and, I mean, you name it. There are people, Samsung, I could sit here for an afternoon like just talking about all the people that we've worked with to get this out to the world. And they have very varied requirements. They require running on AWS. They require running on bare metal. They require running on Mesosphere. Because those are the needs of their business. And so from our perspective, what we wanted to do is make Kubernetes the common place to deploy your containers, run them at scale, and support all the environments that that customers require. And what that allows is that last line on the slide, which is it lets you manage applications instead of machines. Once those clusters are set up underneath your machines, you don't care about it. You know, maybe once a week you'll log in and you know, reboot it because there's a kernel patch or something like that. Your application doesn't care, everything else, all your developers don't care, you just deploy to Kubernetes, everything else is taken care of for you. We don't need to go too much into this, but basically, you know, the idea is today you start with a fairly inefficient infrastructure that's well tied to VMs or bare metal or whatever might be running under the hood. You start by using containers, which gives you that layer of isolation. You just need the dependencies that let you run. You bring it to production with something like Kubernetes, and it really gives you faster deployments. You can roll out as fast as you can type. And it lets you respond to your customers much more quickly. I already talked about Kubernetes runs everywhere. These are some corporations who are already adopting it, talking about it publicly. You should go subscribe to our blog. We talk about them all the time on our blog, highlighting what people are doing with it in production, betting their company on it. One of the fundamental things there, are you guys familiar with this analogy, pets versus cattle? So the idea is that the pet, you care for it, you bring it home, you pet it on the head. If it gets sick, you bring it to the vet, give it medicine. Cattle gets sick, shoot it in the head, get another cow. That's the idea behind containers. You don't try and repair your container. You can take it offline and hold it there so you can debug and get great isolation out of it in the debugging. But your job is not to log in and fix whatever's going on there. Your job is to use your initial deployment object or fix your initial deployment object and come back. Okay, the 1,000-foot view of containers. Anyone, or Kubernetes, anyone too fast, too slow? Any questions so far? Okay. So, the 1,000-foot view. On the left-hand side, you have people. They interact with what we call the Kubernetes master. They do it via an API, so every control in the entire Kubernetes is interacted with via API. Or a CLI, which is a very thin wrapper over the top of the API. Or a UI, which is a very thin wrapper over the API as well. You have some basic things in the main, in the master. You have an API server, which basically allows you to make all these commands. You have etcd, which does distributed state. You don't have to manage it. Kubernetes takes care of that for you, but we use it internally to distribute state so that there's no single point of failure. You have a scheduler, and then you have some controllers, and that's it. It's quite simple, and that's all you interact with. The magic happens on the right-hand side, which are your nodes. So what you'll do is you'll bring up a Kubernetes, or you'll bring up a node, often a VM. On it, you'll put some very simple binaries, a Docker daemon, maybe systemd if you're using Rocket, a kubelet, which is a binary you get from Kubernetes. Make some basic configurations, and then tell Kubernetes that I exist and you can start scheduling to me. And at that point, Kubernetes will start handing out jobs across its network. And that's it. You don't have to do that manually. Normally, you do that once and once only when you're setting up your auto-scaling group or your managed instance group, or if you're using GKE, it's done for you. But you do it once, and then you now have this, which is you have an API that you interact with, and behind that you have a container cluster. And you don't know anything about it. You just say, I need this application to run it on 25 times, each of which need one CPU, go do it, and it figures it out for you. We don't need to dive too much in here, but basically this is what I was just saying. There's some setup at the beginning. These are some of the setups. You guys are all using, you folks are all using GKE, Google Container Engine, which will do all this for you. And there are other hosted solutions. Tectonic, Apprenda has an, Kubernetes-based has OpenShift from Red Hat, and lots of other folks. And like I said, the second half of it is once you decide, once this is all set up, you just start running. You run pods, you run controllers, create volumes, and so on. Okay, so far so good? Quick check-in. Okay, so there are about 5-ish concepts I'm going to walk through here, and at the end of it, you're going to be experts, I promise, and be able to run whatever you want. Okay? All right. Number one, a pod. 98% of the time, when I say pod, you can substitute in your head container. And you're like, well, why'd you come up with a new name? It's because, again, seeing what we saw inside of Google, it was very, very common that you would have two containers or three containers that would always need to be scheduled next to each other. For example, this example right here, let's say you have two processes that you normally need to make your app work. You have a web server, which serves web traffic just like normal, and then you have a file puller, like that might go out and get a bunch of thumbnails, or might get the logs from last night, or might, who knows what, right? Every 10 minutes, it wakes up, it runs a process, it breaks it down. Best practice in the container world is to actually build those into two separate containers. So, back to pod. So the idea is, you might have a log shipper, for example. Maybe you use Splunk, great product, already containerized, works great on Kubernetes. You would put that in its own container. Or maybe you're doing, maybe you want to do SSL end-to-end encrypted. A common thing today would be you might have an SSL cert and then talk to your application over localhost, because then it would terminate at the Nginx installation that was on the SSL, but then only talk to your application via localhost, so no over the air traffic. Perfect example where this works. That is called the, by the way, the sidecar pattern for this thing. So the idea is, vast majority of the time, 98% of the time, one pod, one container, very easy. We built this so that you had the flexibility to respond to whatever you need to do from a business perspective. There's more power here too. Those pods can communicate over localhost. They share a common disk and mount point. So they really are almost like they are running in the same container, but they're not. They just happen to be in the same container namespace. Okay.
So a memory is the only reason? So they each have their own memory?
No, it's actually just a best practice from software development perspective. They don't all each have their own memory because that's at the pod level. Because they share a container namespace. So the best practice from a software development, you bring up your container, you run a bunch of unit tests on it, and you figure out, make sure that works, and then you push that to production, right? Well, if you have two side by side, you're able to do that independently. And for example, rev just one, like, okay, Splunk has a new agent, I'm gonna upgrade that agent, run my unit tests against it, run my integration tests against it, and then push out the pod together. It's just it lets you break it down, and it brings loose coupling, which is the real power here, right? Loose coupling everything together, even into that like thing, that very narrow space.
Yeah.
Okay. You saw in there a volume. So the idea is, by and large, you should treat a container as a read-only object. It's not 100% true because it's trying to write things there, but you shouldn't trust that anything is going to be there. If you want to do something where there's state, where the data sticks around longer than just the life of the container, you would want to use something like a volume, which is very similar to a Docker volume. Unfortunately, it's not the same. So whatever your experience is with Docker volumes, you would have to relearn it. There's not a ton here. I can show you how to do that. But suffice to say, it is different. But it's very similar in concept. There are many different volume plugins. This is just a small subset so that you can actually read the slides. Walking down, you can mount an empty directory, which is guaranteed to be empty when it comes up, so you can use it forever, whatever you want. You can mount something in from the host path. Vast majority of the time, that should be read-only mounting. You should almost never mount something in from your host that is read-write, unless you have a really good reason. You can use a Git repository. That's actually a really cool feature where, especially if you have read-only content, you can just pull it down when that pod comes up and it'll always be latest and things like that. Persistent disk, CentFS, Gluster, Flocker, there's a secret volume, and I can show you how to use that in a second. But regardless, this is the way you bring data into your container that you didn't have at potentially build time. Okay, we're already through two concepts. This is great progress. Everyone's happy? Okay, next concept. The concept of the replication controller. Actually, this slide is out of date as of yesterday. This has been renamed to replica set. But suffice it to say, there's no binaries here. There's nothing here other than a concept. And the concept is, you tell Kubernetes how many pods you need to run for your application. That's it. Kubernetes says, okay, I've got a replica set. I'm ready to go. I know how many I'm supposed to run. I'm going to watch it for you. And that's all it does. So every whatever, you know, it does a watch, and it says how many are there and how many am I supposed to have, and then it brings it, it converges it. You know, once every 2 seconds or something like that. So super, super fast. This, by the way, is one of the most powerful things in Kubernetes because, again, you don't care where this stuff is being scheduled to. You don't care what the specific profiles are. You say go do it, and it does it. But on top of that, it's also extremely parallelizable. So those of you that use Swarm, for example, that's all serial. You'll start up a bunch of containers, and it'll tick them out one at a time. Replica sets are 100% parallelizable. So you tell it to start up 1,000, and it'll go talk to all your nodes simultaneously and start spinning them up on the fly. Extremely fast and super reliable.
What did you say is Swarm? What's the
name? Yeah, Swarm does it serially. With Kubernetes, you can manually schedule a container. Or a pod. That's possible. There's a kubectl run, and I can show you that little trick later. But you wouldn't want to do that for any sort of production environment, right? What you would really do is just say, okay, Kubernetes, I now have this application, and these are its specs. And the spec in this case is, I need 4 of these pods. Then Kubernetes figures it out. And in the case where, let's say I have 8 nodes, and I need 6 pods, Kubernetes will talk to all 8 nodes simultaneously, say, hey, do any of you have space? It gets an answer back, and then immediately with the 6 that volunteered and have space, it schedules immediately. And so, in effect, it's about as fast to schedule 1 container as it is to schedule, in that case, 6 containers, because you're doing them all in parallel.
How about if you have like multiple pods and you want to have state space running? Is it also possible to do a master slave setup?
It absolutely is. So it's not extremely elegant right now. The way you would do it for now would be you would have, if all your slaves were the same, you'd have 1 master replica controller. And then you'd have a replica controller for your slaves, if they're all the same. And you would create 2. In the future, in 1.3, which is coming out in about 16 weeks, we're going to have something called pet set. And after I spent all that time bad-mouthing pets, we're going to make it much easier to run a pet. And in that situation, you're going to have pods that have identity. And so you can say, this is this identity thing, and if it goes away, I want you to restart it with the same identity. And by that, you're going to remount in the same disk, you're going to give it the same IP address. If it's ordered, which a lot of times things need to do for quorum, so let's say you need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and number 4 dies, and it needs that number, it's actually going to re-get number 4. So there's a bunch of things it's going to do, and that works already in flight. But suffice to say, the data scenario is not ideal today. You know, internally to Google, candidly, we run everything with distributed and like massive fail capabilities. So that's called like N+1 or N+2. And the idea is that if any single service fails, there's something else out there that can pick up the load for that thing. And any data that was required is distributed across the system. And so you see this in database, NoSQL databases like Cassandra and things like that, where Cassandra literally doesn't have, you know, everything is just maintained locally, and it forms a quorum, and then the data is distributed. And if any one dies, another one is brought up, and then it talks to the others that are remaining there and rebuilds its database in order to do it. That today is the best way to run databases on containers, though plenty of people run databases on containers. You just, this, the standard practice would be you would do exactly what I said. You'd have these separate replication controllers, replica sets. That's gonna take me 6 months to stop saying that. And you would mount in the appropriate data. Okay. All right. We're almost done with terms. Isn't this awesome? Next two terms, labels and selectors. Okay, so this is, again, an incredibly powerful concept. In a lot of ways, we wish we had this in Borg. This was an add-on, but again, based on learning. So the idea is that any object in the system has a label that you attach to it. And in fact, you can have unlimited amount of labels, or not unlimited, 255 labels. Totally arbitrary, name, key, and a value, that's it. And what that lets you do is it lets you apply your business information to that pod in a way that makes sense to you. I'll get to what I mean by that in a second. And then, with that name and value, you can select across the system and make operations against it. So let me show you what that looks like. So what you see up there are four pods running on the system. Each of the pods has three labels. The label for each on the left-hand side is the key, and on the right-hand side is the value. So for the first top left one, you'll have an app, my app, base, prod, production, role, front end. So what you can do is then you can say, let's say I want to do, you know, I want to bring my application down. I can say select all pods where then the label, the key is app, and then value is my app, and operate. And then there you go. So super straightforward, works in the way that makes sense for you. These aren't things that came from Kubernetes. We're not smart enough to know your business. All we know is that lots of people have ways of labeling things, and we want to give them the power to do it. And the biggest thing here is we also saw people do crazy things when it comes to naming their objects when they don't have this avenue, right? Your VM is named like US West 1C, you know, front end app controller version 2571. Because you needed that information somewhere, and then you build these scripts that parse, you know, underscores and split it and figure out where the IP of the address is, and you're like, Jesus Christ.
VMware.
Right. So this requires none of that. And it's important because we don't want you to know where the IP address is. We really don't. We want you only to care about the things that matter to your application. So I showed you this, and then you can say, well, I just want to select the front end. You can combine them. You can say, I just want to do the back end. I want to do the, you know, production. I want to do the test. Again, the idea is any combinations available to you with 255 different labels per, you know, and you have to see someone run out of space. Okay. So now there's two more things. These aren't new concepts, they're just the way that we decided to do them. The first is networking. Something that we learned, a very painful experience. Can I have something to drink? A very painful experience inside of Google, I think. Was port brokering. Who loves knowing what port something needs to run on and making sure that nothing else is trying to grab that port and writing bash scripts to see if that port is taken, and if it is, you gotta go take a new one, and then you have to update your service discovery because, you know, that wasn't the standard port. Isn't that crap? Yes, it's great, I love it. Okay, with Docker networking, unfortunately you run into that problem. And the reason is because their networking is based on a node basis. So what happens is, you'll have a Docker container running on one, and then you may have a second one, and each one of those will get an IP address. But then if you have a new node, it's not aware of the node that the previous container was starting on, so it's gonna restart with whatever it knows about, and so on and so forth. And what that means is you have to NAT in between all of those ports, or excuse me, all of those containers, and you have to be aware of what all they are and how things are being updated.
And then you get awesome stuff like this, where you have to like figure it out and SNAP between it and make everyone aware when things change. And if it goes down, we're able to reacquire the port that you sent previously and make sure to check every time before, because the port that you thought was there is now gone. Now, all right. So what we did in Kubernetes is we said everything gets its own IP address across the entire system. I can call it IP per pod. And we don't solve the problem for your cluster. If you have a flat network, this is a piece of cake. If you have a more complicated network, you're going to have to do a little bit of work, but you're probably already having to do a little bit of work because your VMs need to figure out how to talk to each other and they're going to have permissions. So whatever you're using to do accomplish that, it's likely you're going to be able to use the same thing with Kubernetes. But that said, it makes it so that every pod can talk to every other pod, and it gets its own IP address, which makes it incredibly easy to find it, route to it. And you can do L3 routing, you can build an underlay network where you wire all your nodes together and make sure that's what they use. You can do an overlay network inside the container itself to get its own pod, IP address. But Kubernetes does fundamentally believe in the one pod, one IP per pod. So the diagram looks like this, and there's nothing more complicated. On the left-hand side, you'll have a node with an individual IP address. Doesn't matter what's under the hood. But inside the cluster itself, it's going to have IP addresses that are routable everywhere. Yes?
You just mentioned the slides. The link to the slides are in the software service comments now. So for people who are having trouble.
All right. Last concept, I promise. This isn't even a new concept again. This is just how we chose to do it. So I'm now showing you the power of networking, showing you power labels and selectors. We're all good. Any questions? I've made one kind of fast. Everyone good? Honestly, no problem. Ask away. All right. So in Kubernetes, the real magic happens here, where you have a virtual IP address. You'll create a service. And that service will have a virtual IP address that anything can access and can be accessed from any node. That service is based entirely on the label and the selector. Okay? So let me show you how this works. First, you have your API server. And your API server gets notified when your node comes up. I'm a node out here. I'm going to watch, there's a watch endpoint. Anytime you have an API, anytime you update a service endpoint, I want you to tell me about it. Very straightforward. Again, you don't have to do it. So now I come along and I say, kubectl run, go, run an application. Here's the pod, and here's the labels that sit behind it. App equals my app. So the pod goes out, the API goes out to the individual node and schedules. Then I say, okay, now I want to expose a virtual endpoint that routes to app equals my app. So anytime app equals my app, I want you to go to those pods that I just started. So the kube proxy, which is watching that watch API, is now updated because I said expose this. Kubeproxy then goes and configures IP tables on that local machine and creates that virtual IP address. And then the API master says, hey, there are these pods out there that match that selector that I told you about. And here's the IP addresses that they have published for themselves. And then Kubeproxy goes and updates IP tables with that information. And then you have random round robining between them. So, client comes in, talks to the virtual IP address, virtual IP address talks to the randomizer, and goes out and, or in fact, it just round robins. But it goes out and finds it. That's simple. But again, all you had to do, I hope you saw, two commands. Run my thing, and expose an endpoint. And then you're golden. Right? All right. That's it. Those are the concepts. Your experts, go out to the world. Okay, so now, what I'd like to do, you could all go here. My last name's Aronchick. I forked this from Kelsey Hightower, the brilliant Kelsey Hightower. This is the lab that we're going to be going through today. And
how about the page you want to?
This one. The first half of it is an on-premises lab for setting things up. You're welcome to come back and mess around with that if you have a situation with your on-premises. The good news is, because you're on GKE, you don't have to worry about any of that stuff. gcloud is the local command line tool for all of Google Compute platform. And inside that is kubectl that you saw earlier. Or actually, it's not inside it technically, but you get the idea. And once you do that, then we're going to start, we're going to be able to skip half the demos and just jump down. Cool?
Can also,
yes.
Can you also do it in the browser console?
Oh, no, unfortunately. As of yesterday, we announced Kubernetes 1.2 in beta. The good news is it is awesome, and it's got a great UI, and it's super easy to use. The downside is that it's not available on GKE yet, and as a result, the UI is not available on GKE. It will be by the end of the month.
Should we walk them through how to install gcloud?
You go to cloud.google.com/sdk, that should give you some install instructions.
Oh. This thing changes literally once a week.
There's a little button up here called Activate Cloud Shell, and what it does is it fires up a little virtual machine with the gcloud install on it, all the authentication set up for you, all the permissions created, and it gives you a very small home directory, like 500 megabyte home directory, where you can do your own scripting. So you can sort of, even without installing anything local on your computer, you can just start running these API commands. Because it's sort of silly for you to have to install stuff on your computer in order to interact with an API. So we basically helped you.
You want to try our first thing?
Yep.
Wow, that was easy.
Cool.
All right. I'm realizing something here. Here's the thing we need to do. We need to build a container in order to run it. Now the standard is some hello world Nginx thing. Do that. We can show everyone how to build a container and then push that container up if you'd like. Although then we have to. Oh, you can do what you start. On the fly, we're going to download
and run a container.
So go to my repository, github.com, whack. Aronchick, and down here on the left you have Kubernetes KAS-blue-green. Does everyone have Docker installed, by the way? The problem is that some people who don't have Docker installed are going to have problems doing that, and we'll figure out a solution. Okay, we're going to skip by that. Let's go back. We're going to go to open up a text editor, and we're going to have you create your first Kubernetes manifest. Remember when I said that a Kubernetes manifest is really, really, really straightforward? You can, in my GitHub repository, if you don't mind going to kas-blue-green/, and then there's a file in there called client-purple-rc. What I'm gonna do is walk you through this, and then it's always a good exercise, in my opinion, for you to write, even if I'm just telling you, no copying and pasting, to write words down so that you understand what's going on. There's not a lot of complexity here, but I'm gonna ask you to write it, not copy and paste it, okay? The first line is application. It just says what the version is. So in this case, application colon v1. That's it. You use that to tell the Kubernetes API master what version it's supposed to execute against, because we're obviously going to have multiple API now and versions. The second is the, What's that?
Is the case sensitive to be important?
I think so. Let's just pretend it is. I'm not 100% sure. I'd be surprised. I'd be surprised if it was. Now I've not killed it. I'd be surprised if it was the case sensitive is important, but let's do it just in case. Okay, the next is the kind of manifest that you're talking about here in this case. It's replication controller, soon to be replica set. That's it, really straightforward, kind, replication controller. The next is some metadata that you're telling the API server about this, which are a series of labels. In this case, it's just
So you do metadata, colon, next line, name, colon, client dash purple, or you can do client dash whatever you want. Make it custom. Okay, so far so good? Now, next line down, this is the specification of the thing you're gonna replicate. So in this case, you're saying spec, colon, next line, and the most important thing here are tabs will fail. So white space is important. Next, sorry. So the next line down is the number of replicas you want. Replicas, in my case, 2, you can have 70, it doesn't matter. Next line down is the selector. I talked about that power before. Selector, colon, name, colon, or excuse me, selector and then a bunch of labels underneath it. I chose name and version here. You can choose whatever you want. It doesn't matter. But you just need, at least, in this case you need 2 to show you what I'm gonna demo. And then you have the template of the thing that you're replicating. Because you're gonna have a bunch of replicas of it, you know, this is all, it has to be repeatable. So, next line down, we have metadata, again, and that's to refer to the thing that you're replicating. Line under that, you have labels. And again, choose 2 labels, make them whatever you want, don't care. Yeah?
They don't.
The selector for the above is the selector for the replication controller. The selector for this is a selector for the pods that you're spinning up. Does that make sense?
Why is it called selector and now labels?
This is probably wrong. It probably should be selector in both places. I bet we just synonym. Okay, and then now we get to the spec of the container, the actual thing that you're running. So again, you need another spec. Put in there containers, and this is where you would have multiple containers if you were doing multiple containers. And below that, you have the image, dash image, colon, and there, one time you're allowed to copy paste. This is an image from my repository. You can feel free to use it. Below it is name equals client. Now the confusing part here is this client is not a selector. This is something else. So it's unfortunate that I think it is a best practice now not to use name as a label because of this, because this is actually a construct in the system. We're going to skip over live in this probe, but again, I mentioned earlier about how easy it was to have Kubernetes check the health of your system and make sure everything's up and running. But we will need that last thing down there at the bottom, that last section, which is the port that is opening on. So in this case, ports, colon, and then underneath it, you do dash container port, and we'll use 3000. And under that, protocol, colon, TCP. Okay? Talk really fast, but give you all time to catch up. Because you're typing and not copying and pasting. And off browsing Twitter, right?
Yes. Yes. See lies. Where are lying eyes?
Alright. Congratulations. You have successfully built a Kubernetes manifest. What are you gonna do with it? Well, let's let's go start ourselves a cluster. Okay. So, over here, in the left-hand side, can everyone see that super washdown? Left-hand side of the drop-down, you have a menu that folds out. You can either start typing at the top. Of course, it's Google. Everything is searchable. But you can, or you can browse down. To container engine down there. And this is a nifty little trick, this is something I do. On here you can actually pin this, and so you don't even need that. Once you pin it, it appears up here forever, which is super convenient for me since I only do container. So you go down here, you container engine. Your container engine will not look like this. Yours will be a large wizard-looking thing. You should have a big blue button. Now is the time to click the big blue button. You are now presented with your some details about your cluster. You can choose whatever you want here. Name whatever you want. Europe, West, sure, sounds good. I'd probably make it, leave the machine type's fine. The cluster size can be 4, 3, doesn't matter. We're just getting started. You can leave cloud monitoring on and cloud logging. That's basically it. When you are done, click create, and you're done. Now this is going to take, unfortunately, a little bit of time. You got to spin up VMs, provision things, all that good stuff. But we'll have a cluster here momentarily. Again, this is the kind of thing you really only need to do once-ish. If I'm inside a cluster, in GKE, Kubernetes is creating what's called a managed instance group. Does everyone know what that is? So in gcloud, Google Cloud, we have something called a managed instance. It's similar to an auto-scale group, or if you use OpenStack, it's like Magnum. It's basically a template for a VM, and then a way to manage the replication of that VM a number of times. And then on top of that, it'll do a bunch of health checking and let you target it with a load balancer and things like that. So all that's going on for you. In this case, we have an instance group. Kubernetes is creating an instance group for you. And so let's say you had this cluster and it was configured exactly like you wanted, but it only had 3 VMs. You could go in to here, you would go to Compute Engine, and you'd click on this name, and then you'd say Edit Group, and you literally add instances or take them away or whatever. Because the template's already there, it's going to grab that template, it's going to create more, and then add those automatically to the cluster. In 1.3, Kubernetes 1.3, Kubernetes will, or GKE will do that for you for if you need additional compute on GKE, and we will make it possible. We will work with Amazon and other folks to help them do it. We don't control them, obviously. But it will be very powerful. So like, if you schedule 1,000 containers and you only have enough space for 500, it will go out and grab more compute for you. Okay? If you have gcloud running, and we all do, right? Gcloud components update kube control, KubeCtl. And then yes, that'll work. Changing projects. You want to do gcloud, just do gcloud config set project and then the project name. And make sure you're in the right zone. Because you can change. One more thing, we need to inform kube control of the permissions of your cluster. Really straightforward. What I want you to do is type gcloud container clusters get dash credentials and then the name of the cluster that you just created, cluster one if you use the default. We are about to begin and run our first container on a cluster. So what I want you to do is, to start, I would like you to go and grab that URL that you see right there on my GitHub, going all the way over to 0. Just grab it. And what we're going to do is, we're going to do this so that it's not, this isn't terribly production ready, to be honest with everyone. But it's just going to get it starting, and we're going to show you how to like interact with kube control. So what I want you to do is do kube control, run, pick a name, great name, dash dash, image, and then that, then just paste in from my URL. Boom. You are now running it. Kubectl get
pods. Those are some other ones that I've run previously on the same cluster. What do you have?
Yep.
Success? You have a pod. It is running on Kubernetes, on Google Cloud. Look at how easy that looks. Piece of cake. Alright. Alright, nice. So now, get RC. So all the objects are available, right? And we use a very standard verbs for everything. So in this case, do kubectl get RC. Okay? In this case, again, I have some old ones running on a different cluster, but it should show you the RC that you're looking for. Okay? One pod, that ain't interesting. Here's what would be cool. How about 20 pods? Well, let's do that. All right, I want you to type kubectl scale, S-C-A-L-E, space RC, kubectl scale, your replication controller. See how we're piecing these together? The name of your replication controller that you created. Remember when we created that thing called name and it just showed when you said get RC. And then dash dash replicas equals whatever. 75, 21, 12. 75 will probably start to work, but you get the idea.
Yeah.
All right? What?
So it's 75.
That's okay. Well, remember, and again, this is the power of containers. The containers are bound by the space, right? So you're paying for compute, and you want to use as much of that compute as you can. So it's fine to do 75 and then have them fail, because they'll just sit there waiting for his computer to fail. Yeah. Awesome. You don't need 20 VMs. This is containers. Containers don't care about VMs. They are totally separate. All right? So who's got up to 20? Good? Are we running? You got 20. This is so awesome. But now it's the middle, it's no longer the middle of the day, it's night, you don't care anymore. Let's leave it as an exercise to the reader, bring it down to 3. Piece of cake, right? Bring it up, bring it down, do whatever you want. You're good. All right, now this is fun. Let's do one little fun thing. I'll just, this is a little thing for great for debugging purposes. Go and do get pods. So kubectl get pods. And you will see some pods there. Grab any named pod you'd like. Doesn't matter which one. And now I want you to log in to this pod. I want you to type kubectl exec. Now, when we say exec, we are now execing directly against the Docker instance that is running this container. So kubectl exec ti. I do the name of the pod, and I'm going to do a bash shell.
Why don't you just use attach?
You can't use attach. Attach works perfectly well. I knew this. But attach is another way of accomplishing the same. And the thing is that this pod won't work with attach. And the reason is because it's already running a process. And so you would attach to the shell that was already there. So here I am. I am now inside the container. Okay? Alright, now I am malicious, so I am going to shut this down. What do you think is going to happen?
Restart another instance.
I don't know. That doesn't sound very production ready to me. Restarting an instance if something fails doesn't seem like our mentality. There we go. Container dead. Boo! Alright, so what happened? Well, let's see. Kubectl get pods. It has been respawned. Now in this case, because I killed it, it was able to restart the previous one. It could also be the case that it just restarted and created a brand new controller. Doesn't matter which. Again, the idea is you shouldn't care about which has started and stopped. Okay? Alright, so good times. Now, let's stop the controller that you created. This is very easy. Kubectl stop RC, and in this case, it might have named bring.
Yeah, but this is super menu.
Okay? We're just going to break it down because I'm going to show you an alternative using that YAML file, that manifest that you created before. Okay? So I stop, and it's bringing down a pod. It stops the controller and brings down and deletes it. Sure. All right. Now, remember we did all that work copying and pasting down the file? We're going to use that now. Find your file. I want you to I want you to type Q control create dash F. So that means Q control is going to create whatever you give it. And in this case, I'm going to give it a file. And the file is what you typed before. Now this is, I know I'm opening up myself up for disaster because everyone makes mistakes and you're going to have this pain in the butt where it's validating, but nonetheless, type your file name. In my case, it was purple, and you can return and it will go and create that. In this case, there you go. Right. So now that I've done this, how do I know it's running? Let's go check it out. If you control get RC, there it is. Running, and now keep control, get pods. And you'll see your pods there at the end of the line. Okay? So, what did I show you? Well, you can do it via the command line, but your best practice is actually to do it via files, because files can now be checked in as configuration, and people pull them, and all that good stuff. So you can do it via files. There's a trick that people don't know about a lot of times, which is you can do it not just on a file, but an entire directory. So you could have all your applications' files that you want to create in a directory and just do kubectl-f directory name, and it'll do it. And the recommendation is you should really have one config object per file. You can actually put these, stack them together. But your best bet is, in fact, to like have them all in a directory, one file at a time. Okay? All right, well, one more thing to go. You're not able to use your stupid sweet app that you built, right? We gotta fix that. So let's get to that. So, there's another file that I'm gonna ask you to type out. This is a much smaller file. This is service. So you heard me earlier say expose. Expose means you create that service virtual endpoint that I talked about earlier. This one's just a few lines. First line, API version, just like before, you can copy and paste it from your other one. V1. Second line, kind is service. Is that a replication controller? Third line, you're going to do metadata, labels, colon, client service in this case. Again, do whatever you want. Doesn't matter. And then you have a second label in there, which is name. And that should matter. It's confusing. I know. Don't worry. Does everyone see this? The metadata has three lines in it, one of which is indented. And these two need to match. It's annoying. It will be fixed, I promise. You just copy and paste this stuff. And then you come down here to this section where you do spec, colon, and then the thing that you're creating. In this case, we're going to create ports. One is the external port, port 80. And the second is the target port, which is the port on your container itself, or your pod, which we said previously was 3000. And then you need a selector. And the selector is the name of the things, the pods, that you used in your other file. So you need to have a selector, and it's going to be that key value pair, name, colon, and then the other thing. And then the final line, type, colon, load balancer. That's not necessary. It will be in this case, because what's going to happen is,
Kubernetes, or GKE is going to go and create a load balancer for you and point it at all your nodes. And the nodes then will load balance up to your pods. It works today on AWS, I want to say OpenStack and GKE and GC. I'm not 100% sure on OpenStack, but it does work on all those other places. If it doesn't work, it's not hard. All you need to do is have a load balancer that goes directly against your nodes, and your nodes will know how to figure out where to go. But that doesn't mean you're doing this weird hopping thing. In the ideal case, you have some system that you can use, like a little widget that checks every 1 second if any services have been added, and you add them directly to your load balancer. Now, it's trivial to do. Again, everything in Kubernetes is available via API, and there are some examples in our example directory how to do that with HAProxy or Nginx and things like that. But right, you know, unfortunately, it's the nature of the beast. We can't support every load balancer in the world until they cover out. Listen to my words. Don't copy and paste. It needs to match this selector, right? Oh, no, this selector right here. The one inside your template is the one that it should match. Actually, I'm 95% sure on that. We may have a whole bunch of people getting wrong bugs. Anyhow, we'll see what happens. And we know what the alternative would be. If you can't, if it doesn't work, we'll say switch. But yeah. Okay. So let's create your service endpoint. Kubectl create dash f. That file you just typed. And return. Selector in this selector. Oh, it should match. It should match, I believe it should match this one right here. I'm fairly certain of that. Everyone good? Everyone good? All right, so the answer is this template, this label here must match that. The answer is this selector label here must match this metadata. The answer is the answer. So the service selector is going to have to look for this. So the service is going to look for that, this right here. This selector. Right here. Alright? So far so good? Now did everyone create their service? Any failures? Alright. How will we find out about this? Well, let's see. Kubectl. And I see all my services. And not only that, I should see, if you did it right, a number in this external IP. Let's take a look at our YAMLs of our services, because I bet people have created, not add type-only load routes.
We're going to do two things here that you would need to do when using Kubernetes in production. We're going to do a rolling update. First, let's go back, let's get your pods.
All right, everyone see the pods? So just to prove that these are in fact two different pods running, or that the service endpoint is round robbing, please go and exec into your pod. Kubectl exec ti pod name bash. Okay? Good? Now, I want to prove to you that this is an actual
So virtual IP address, a virtual name, that you don't actually care where this pod is. I want you to type kubectl http, your service name, in my case it's client-service, and then do slash JSON, which is a JSON rendering of the page that you saw earlier. Okay? And you hit return, and it returns a little JSON block. So again, that's the rendering of what you saw earlier. And I want you to hit the up arrow and type again, and then the up arrow and type again, and the up arrow and type again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and again. Okay? Now what do you see there that's kind of cool? Well, I didn't know anything inside this container, inside this pod. I didn't know anything about the other pods that existed in the system. I didn't have to understand IP addresses or anything like that. I just kept hitting one endpoint, and that was a fully qualified domain name endpoint based on the name of my service that had been injected into my pod. Does that make sense? So really powerful. It means you don't have to run an agent inside your pod in order to do service discovery. It automatically is available because everything uses DNS. It's awesome, right? Now I want you to open your client-purple. Sorry, don't open it, make a copy of it. And now in your new copy, I want you to change the version number anywhere you have version number from 2.0.0 to 2.0.1. Now this is, imagine you have just finished building on your local desktop the container, the Docker container, for the new version of your application. In this case, that button that you saw earlier, I changed it completely. Now we see the power of Kubernetes. I want you to go and create that replication controller for blue, not purple. Oh, sorry, actually, before you do that, in that version, you do have to change the name at the top. I'm sorry, I did forget that. The name of the metadata should be client-blue or whatever you want to do. Create the new replication control. How do we do that? Kubectl create-f, new name. You now have two replication controllers operating independently, each of which are watching their pods, each of which are watching the version of the application they're responsible for, and you didn't shut the other one down. So, you know, who likes DevOps crap here? DevOps? This is a blue-green deployment. This is it, in Kubernetes. Or Canary, maybe you've heard of Canary deployments? Canary deployment is where you would deploy one and watch that one and you fold it into your endpoint. How do you think you fold it into our client service endpoint? Who wants to take a guess? Anyone? Be brave, come on. Go. Through the service, correct. What do you have to do to the service to make it now respond to this new endpoint? It is a trick question.
Nothing.
Although, nice job. Be brave. Good trick job, be brave. Because the label here is the same, the client service, which uses that selector, is pulling it in. So it's there. Now, unfortunately, we were seeing some sticky issues. Normally, I would go to the browser and hit refresh, 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 and that should work. Let's see. I wrote a little dashboard that does this, but well, let's just go into the container itself, and you can prove it to yourself. So just a second. So if you do kubectl get pods, and it doesn't matter which pod you get, just grab one, and you get into it, ti, name, bash, okay, I'm in the container, and now I'm just going to curl that endpoint, http, oops, client-service slash JSON. So right here it says color, and it's got one color. If I keep hitting it, the color name is returning wrong. But you can see the host name is correct.
Yeah.
Everyone see that? And theoretically, if you kept hitting refresh in your browser window every 2 out of 4, because that would serve half of them, would be blue, and 2 out of 4 would be purple. And presto, you've done it. But this also means that you can do zero downtime deployments, right? Because your customers only knew about this endpoint. They knew how to refresh, they knew how to do all this stuff. They're just hitting your browser, that's great. And then you put this up, things look great, you bring the other one down, no downtime. Remember, if you deployed right away when I was talking about the demo, I had forgotten to change the name.
So then it would have replaced the template.
So it would have replaced the template, exactly right. The metadata name. That's what it uses. That's basic containers 101. Kubernetes 101. You're now able to do Netflix style deployments. No joke. I mean, when people talk about Netflix being so awesome or Google being so awesome, that's 95% of it right there. You build into a container, you take care of your dependencies, you roll out, you build something new, you roll it out on the same thing, you test it, it's really great, you bring down the old thing, no downtime, awesome. And Kubernetes takes care of everything when it comes to keeping that stuff up and running, keeping it healthy, making sure the right number are out there, so on and so forth. Okay? Yeah, so I can bring down the other one. So I'll do 2 more little demos here. Now that I've created the blue one and it's operating properly, I go and I can stop the old one. That's a piece of cake, right? And then if I go to my browser, now all buttons are blue, that's all that's left. Now inside of Kubernetes, there's a brand new feature called deployment. I'm not gonna get to that now, which lets you do what I'm about to do on the server side, which is very reliable. But what you can also do is, you can move from one version to another as a first class object. So in this case, I have another one called rolling update. I'm going to take one replication controller. You see there, client blue is a replication controller. I have another image in the repo. You can all go and look at it, called green. That makes the button green. I do rolling update, and I have an update period of 0.1 seconds, and I hit return. And now, what it's going to do is, it's going to look at those, it's going to say, keep it running, keep 6 available, make sure not to exceed 7. It's going to scale 1 green up, then bring 1 blue down, make sure everything is healthy, and then continue all the way through. So, now deployment makes it even better. So you guys should go read up on deployment, which is coming out right now. So there's a basic health check, which just sees that the container is loaded and running. But the liveness probe that you saw earlier is how you do the health check. If that's missing, it'll just see if the container's running. So how to scale down?
So imagine you have a connection.
Drain. There are drains. I am not 100% on exactly how we do container drain. I'm not 100%. I believe there's some constructs in there now. In the very near future, we're going to add a bunch of things, including node drain and client and pod drain, richer stuff. So do jump into, if you have some particular thoughts, jump into the GitHub repo. We talk about all this stuff openly. Though I love Kubernetes, or GKE, I'm also the PM for Kubernetes, meaning the open source side. Everything that we talk about is talked about in open source first, and you guys should go check it out. So there is draining and thoughts around that. There's additionally something that you may be able to use today, which are called, lifecycle hooks. So pre-start, post-start, pre-stop, and post-stop, you can put some code in there and execute it before, I guess that's the end of the hands-on. So let me ask a quick question. Who is using or wants to use containers for their own company versus
Who wants to use containers to sell, to package software that they want to sell to somebody else? Or who wants to use containers or Kubernetes to make money on Kubernetes itself as kind of a third-party add-on, either SI, like your consulting services, or potentially building on top of the ecosystem? Who's for number one? Using it yourself? All right. Anyone number two? Nobody wants to ship software? Shipping software, like you're an ISV and you want to ship software? All right, well, that's very interesting. And number three, build on top of the Kubernetes ecosystem? Got some good? Good, good. That's great. We love all three of those people. And those are the big opportunities I want to stress, right? Obviously, containers makes you much more efficient. You can do rolling updates and, you know, secure deployments and all that good stuff. Containers are just great no matter what you do. But, you know, I strongly believe this, and I do talk to a lot of folks. Splunk is a perfect example, right? Splunk right now has to build 75 different, like, client versions that they ship to everybody, like, on Ubuntu 12.0.2, you know, with Latvian dialect. I have no idea, right? And containers are a solution to that, right? If you containerize your application, you can ship that, and you can ship via a Kubernetes manifest that you can just update for them, right? And then magically it appears on their system. So that's a really big opportunity to make your job supporting your own software much easier. No one's shipping software in here, so nobody cares. And then the third space, I cannot stress enough how big the Kubernetes ecosystem is, even now. I mean, the product has only been GA for 9 months, and we had 800 people at a conference yesterday. And that was the second conference. So there's a huge amount of money to step in and be made on this. And to be clear, if I have not been already, Kubernetes does not have a business model. I will stress that again. We do not have a business model. Nobody will ever make money selling Kubernetes by itself. Now, you're saying, why are you saying this? Isn't this meaning the product's gonna go away? No. We at Google use it to host Google Container Engine, so we desperately need it. Red Hat uses it to base OpenShift on, so Red Hat desperately needs it. Huawei has just rebased their entire PaaS on top of it. Aprenda, a London-based company, has just rebased their PaaS on it. Deus has just rebased their PaaS on it. It solves so many problems that all these folks, and many, many more, require Kubernetes to exist. So why am I even stressing that it doesn't have a business model? It means that we're not going to expand into your business if you build on top of the Kubernetes ecosystem. So if you have a great new logger that you want to sell on top of Kubernetes, you can be assured that Kubernetes core team is not going to build into it, which is different than some other folks out there who need to make money off their platform and probably are going to go up and down the stack because that's where the money is.
So the first question that came up at the beginning was networking. I think that came from you, right? Like, how the NATing works, how to into it. Was that answered already for you? Do you have additional questions around that? We talked a little bit about how the IP tables get updated on each of the nodes.
I mean, there's so many things happening in the IP table space. What the names are, what gets updated where, what controls what.
Let me ask this. Why do you care?
Because I want to understand.
Ah, well then there you go. So what I would recommend there is, it's an open source project, go look at it. Like, honest to God. I literally can't say words that will answer your question.
And if you have multiple sites.
Multiple sites
out. Multiple clouds, data centers, things get more complicated.
Yeah, well,
and then the things that you really have to understand what's going on.
So that's actually very interesting. No. They don't. So at Google, we operate, again, we use Kubernetes. We don't use Kubernetes, excuse me, we use Borg, our version of Kubernetes. And we are very, very hardcore that every single homogeneous, anytime you break homogeneity, you require a new cluster. So what it means is, that everything needs to be, if you go from one level of data center, one floor in a data center to another, you're talking between two individual Kubernetes clusters, or our equivalent, right? Which means there's no flat networking across those, right? There's no NATing between them. There's just common service endpoints that are published publicly internally to Google. And so things are routed in that way. So you would never NAT between like one node on one floor and one node in another building. You would only do that via public or internally public service endpoints.
Do you want to talk about Kubernetes concepts?
Yeah.
Well, because I mean, if he's thinking about I'm going to run different clusters in different locations,
yeah.
That's something coming in 1.2, right?
No, so in 1.3, so in 1.2, there is already what we call Kubernetes Lite, which will allow the scheduler. So what you can do is, this is not a best practice, mind you, but you can do it because we see people wanting to do it. You could have a single Kubernetes cluster over two zones. We wouldn't recommend that, but you can do it. Some people want to. What we do recommend, that is also in 1.2, is something called node pools, which will allow you to piece together heterogeneous clusters that make sense to you. For example, let's say you need five nodes that are high mem, and you need another five that are SSD, so on and so forth. You can piece those together and put those all under a single cluster. By doing that, you, and in 1.2, the work we did is to let the scheduler be aware of the differences between these types of machines. So you can now say, I want to schedule this pod, and I want it to go to SSD only, for example. And you can accomplish that as part of it. Or you could say, I want it to go to Europe Central 1 instead of Europe Central 2, or some equivalent, right? So that's available in Kubernetes Lite now. In 1.3, we're going to have what we call Kubernetes Proper. And Kubernetes Proper is where you have multiple clusters start up. They will establish a federation relationship between each other, and they will have a common Kubernetes control plane that lets you move, like so you're in US Central 1 and you want to go to Asia 3, you say, take this app and move it to Asia 3 with no downtime, and it'll do it.
No downtime.
Rolling upgrade.
Just like the rolling upgrade.
Just like the rolling upgrade. To be specific, only if you have that. First off, we're not solving in Kubernetes 1.3 data migration. That's a problem that you're going to have to solve on your own, but you'd have to solve it no matter what. And you have to use a service endpoint because you need a virtual service endpoint across both. If you're going directly at any given application, then there'll be some downtime because the application will go down.
There's slides about this. One of our staff engineers talked about this. There's slides on SlideShare. You can just search on SlideShare Kubernetes, and you'll probably find these slides. Just kind of the concepts and not the good things and the challenges and roadmaps of it.
Yep.
But the GitHub Kubernetes, people read that all the time.
Yep. And the Slack channel, we have people in there 24 hours a day, literally 24 hours a day. We have a team in Warsaw. We have a team on the West Coast. And somebody's job is to be there 24 hours a day, not to mention, you know, over 3,000 people who are in there at any given time.
Cool. So the next question, somebody asked about security. And when I dug in a little bit, it was about, you know, verified container builds.
That's it. We've done something very simple, but if you make it a lot more complex about, you know, what gets interfaced with what, you explained quite a lot about the IP tables, automagic configuration.
Yeah.
But in larger scale, is it still?
Well, so to be clear, the best practice is what you really want to do is you want to have developer permission only go in at the top of your CI/CD chain. And you never actually have anyone do anything except for a very small subset of people, except read only against your Kubernetes cluster. And what you do is you check in, like so that's why the benefit of putting this all in code, right? I get to check it in. Once it's checked in, it kicks off a build, it runs it in a test cluster, so on and so forth. I get to look at it, hit a big button if it says yes, then it moves on to the next one, and on and on and on all the way down. And so the only way it got out there was to go through these very defined steps. A developer shouldn't, generally speaking, have direct access to your production cluster. No one should, except for a very small subset. That's how we work at Google. Everyone at Google has access to submit things to Kubernetes, but only after they've passed all these various build things. So that's the best practice. There's another question that you're saying there, which is an important one, which is verified containers, chain of trust, like where it was built, and things like that. I'm going to put my Google hat back on. please go look at Google Container Registry, where we offer a number of secure features built in. You know, we believe very strongly that we are the fastest, cheapest, blah, 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 hosting provider for stuff.
Also bring comfort with those features.
Stay tuned very closely to the Container Registry. I think we'll be quite impressed with the features that come out in the next 12 months around that end-to-end build, very clean, trusted, ensuring that things are operating the way you want.
So the next question that came up was one that we have at the top, we talk about how to handle state and storage and stuff like that. That was from over you.
Yeah.
Do you want to expand on that, or is it just the basic question of what do I do with my database? And
basically, when we are facing, we have a large load of legacy. So I have some kind of database somewhere with a username, user, and a password sequence. I don't want to put that in all kind of configuration files. So I'm going to inject that into my containers.
All right. Way. So I have some excellent news for you. Config map, brand new feature in 1.2. You get to inject configuration directly into your containers via a server-side object that is live updatable, anatomic, and all kinds of good stuff. So that should help with a lot of those legacy things where you don't want to have an external config store. You really just want to like mount a file in. And you can put it in as an environment variable or as a file itself. As far as state and databases and things like that, your best practice is to start with where you are today, right? Today, if you're using a VM, you're gonna have to have a place to figure out where to store that stuff. God forbid the VM goes down, right? You're mounting it on an external drive, or you're mounting it on a local drive, or whatever it might be. Almost anything you do today, you can do on containers. And I do highly recommend, and this is not just because this is my job to recommend, but I do highly recommend, no matter what you're doing today, life gets better in a container, even if it is the exact same application you're running today, just lift and shift it in. And I know you're like, well, that's, you know, your job to say it. No, it is my job to say it, but it's also true. And the reason is because, if nothing else, it gives you super clean portability, right? So VM goes down, how, you know, and let's say you only have one, it's not a replicated app or anything like that, it's super easy to bring up an app, you know, a container on a new machine without doing some special Snowflake configuration, right? Very, very easy, very powerful. That's kind of category one. Category two, it helps enormously with debugging because your container is now running in this process. You can do all kinds of cool things like you can to any other Linux process, right? You can introspect this process and you can isolate it and make sure it's not spiking and there's nothing wrong with the OS. It's just the process running. So that's kind of category two, that's cool. And then category three is, once it's in a container, it lets you start breaking it down more easily into microservices. So lots of people will have like a chef script, for example, with 100 lines in it. Or a bash file or something like that. You lift and shift it. You just take that, copy it, paste it in. Good times. And then you look at line 37. You're like, oh, I installed NTP on this line. All right, well, maybe I better make an NTP service. So you make an NTP service, and you have your app look at that NTP service instead of localhost. Press, you know, that's not hard. Then you delete line 37. Presto. You just start it down the process. And you do that 99 more times and you're done. And like really, it really helps start to break it down. Because once you get into that container, like things start to flow together and you start establishing the network. So, you know, I hope that helps. There are things like MySQL, for example, right? People use it all the time. It is not ready to be in a container. But it doesn't mean you can't run it in a container very, very effectively, right? Remember, the whole purpose of a replication controller is just to watch something and make sure it comes back up after it dies. Processes, you know, containers run forever. There's nothing special about that. So you can run it in there and just mount in an external drive. And that's easy.
I've been having this question a lot myself too, and I'm curious for your opinion. I've seen code examples
of people running Elasticsearch or running MongoDB or other, you know, Cassandra in Kubernetes. As far as I could understand, the only drawback was that it wouldn't do this, couldn't do really do the scaling automatically for you, which you wish you had. But other than that, like it mounts the drives, the disk is, the data is safe on the PD. If the node dies, the new node will attach to the PD. Can you talk about, like, is it ready for that or not?
It is.
What needs to be done?
It absolutely is. The real failure that you can't do out of all that is the power of Kubernetes is this: I don't care what the state of the machines are, I'm just going to run. And if something bad happens, I don't care that much. I'm just going to start more. And so at Google, I think I mentioned already, we run N plus one, for example, for most of our services, which means literally all the things that we have, all the Gmail out there, everyone, 800 million users, however many it is, I think it's over a billion now, a billion users, we have enough capacity to run 2 billion Gmail users. That's how many users or things will run. Literally N plus one. And the reason we do that is because that means that you could lose half of your, more, you could lose it all, theoretically, and your Gmail will still work. You can spend all that time recovering what the hell happened to it. That's probably the biggest loss when your container, when your apps are legacy. They're not ready to just be killed randomly and then recover. So take MySQL, for example. MySQL, it doesn't even take much startup time, right? It's like, start MySQL, it takes like 6 seconds or something, right? So what's the big deal? Well, the big deal is that it doesn't, it's not ready to, if you kill it and it's not ready to be shut down, the first thing MySQL is going to do is go over its data file, making sure it's consistent before it starts. Because the worst case would be that it started assuming that it was consistent, and then you'd really lose data. So that's what the problem is. Versus something like Cassandra, which really is built for distributed systems like that. Again, it doesn't store anything locally. If it dies, first off, it runs it with extra data spread across the network and all kinds of checksums and things like that. And so if one dies, another one comes up, says, I don't know anything, I'm joining, tell me what I'm supposed to remember, and then a bunch of data streams down from the other ones and takes the missing data, there's no missing data, the replicated data, and pushes it over. So it takes care of that for you. That's the real problem, that it's not, that these apps aren't built for this, and you run the risk of loss in that case.
Another approach I've seen is to use the managed data services of whatever provider you're running on, you know, Bigtable or data store on Google. Yep. I'm sure Amazon has various things. But that the one thing, you know, when people are going to Kubernetes, they're really excited about, no lock-in, I can run it anywhere. Yep. So often they want to avoid the managed services. And then it's just a cost-benefit analysis for you of, do I want to use that local managed service, or do I want to make sure I get Cassandra running in Kubernetes the way I want.
Yep.
So, cool. Should we go on to the next? Does that answer your question well enough? Should I go on to the next one before I the next question? Or do we want more state questions?
I think we have agreement.
Yes.
What?
Yes. Yeah. So what you saw here was Kubernetes client side doing the deployment object, which means if I close my laptop and forget all that, it would stop. Not a good thing. We basically took those and moved it up to a server-side object. And now, in the same YAML configuration, and by the way, you can do all this via JSON. I just like YAML better. I hate quotes, so whatever. In the same YAML configuration, you say, you know, I have a replication controller, just like a template, and you say, here's my deployment name, and then you just give it to Kubernetes, and it remembers it. Then you change that deployment object, and you say, okay, I had a replication controller that wanted 4, now I have a replication controller that wants 9, and you hand that to Kubernetes. That's all you do. Kubernetes diffs from the previous deployment, figures it out, and then executes the rolling update on your behalf. So, excuse me. And it does all the things that that you saw there. It has max surge, it has scale down, things like that. Okay, what else? Yes?
Sorry, product, yes.
So, product. We have the job object right now. So, trivially easily, you could write a cron job that kicked off a job object. So like once a day, I, you know, whatever, run some jobs. And those jobs are quite powerful. They all have parallelization and things like that, workflow, all that sort of thing. That said, scheduled jobs is coming as a first class object in 1.3. Everyone know? Does that make sense for everyone? Okay, what else?
We have some, can you give an example of what kind of things you would put in as a secret and how you could actually keep it secret if you're committing to a repository?
Good point. So, best practice for 12-factor is to always separate. You will want a repository of some sort that you interact with when it comes to secrets. Perfect example is a database password, right? You would not want to have your database password available via any repo. So what you would do in this case is you would move the database password up, just have someone who had the authority to know that database password, move, you know, directly interact with Kubernetes, and put it into Kubernetes as a store. They may have their own private store for those secrets, and interact with Kubernetes in a way, but you can encrypt those secrets in your store, and then you know only decrypt them at the point of like pushing them up. They do need to be unencrypted when they get to Kubernetes because Kubernetes needs to mount them in your drive. But the net is they're mounted on the drive as read-only files, and on top of that, they are mounted for root access only. So if someone has root on your machine, you're hosed anyway. But suffice to say that that's the way it works. Obviously, best practice is not to use a database password at all, but to be clear, right? Like, you have some central identity authority system. But, like, that's a good example. What's that? Are they hashed? They're UU encoded, is that what you mean? Like, Base64 encoded?
Yeah, so if you get the next password, you still
have
the
metadata. Oh, hashed in that way. No, because your application needs them, right? So your application needs it in effectively plain text. But again, the secrets are, they should be things that you can't accomplish using an identity system, right? Like you should have an identity system, LDAP or AD or something like that, such that you've identified this thing as being part of this group that has access to this other object. Like, passing around passwords is a disaster, generally. Yes, anyway. Is it possible to set up Kubernetes on premises? So, that's one of the strongest use cases, and the reason why we open source Kubernetes. Google and everyone who contributes to Kubernetes fundamentally believes in hybrid cloud. It's extremely important. We think that people will have clouds, multiple clouds, bring them together, on-premises, laptops, you name it. The idea is that they should all be part of some common deployment fabric so that when you're rolling out applications, it shouldn't be dramatically different to deploy it to your laptop versus deploy it to test cluster versus on-prem versus Google Cloud and so on. That's what Kubernetes provides. Because Kubernetes works in all of these places, Kubernetes, you can write a Kubernetes manifest, create this application, and know that it's going to work everywhere. So that's the idea. Okay, cool. Now, setting up on premises is a little bit of work. You saw it's really not hard, but there are just a bunch of steps, and there are many listed there. You have to set up DNS. Start the DNS controller. You have to move certificates around to make sure all the pods can see each other and have SSL between them. You have to, what else? I know, there's a variety of things. It's not terribly hard, but it is a manual process. And it is a big deal for us to make that much easier for time. Oh yeah. Yeah, kubectl is not a Google Cloud thing.
Oh, it's an
Yeah. Well, no. So actually, kubectl works only on admin and password. Now, it's also via SSL because we push certificates. That's part of the gcloud init process. We push a bunch of certificates down and store them locally so you can communicate privately. But it is basic auth right now. We're going to be adding a bunch of identity stuff for the near future. Okay. So there's some tutorials out there about making the master highly available. It is an important thing to note. The master does not have to be highly available at all. The state for your system is distributed amongst your system. Kubernetes runs on Kubernetes. So all things run in pods, and those pods are distributed throughout the system. So if your master went down, no problem. What would happen is it would mean you couldn't control your pods for the period while your master is down. But the master comes back up in 30 seconds, a minute. It's not much. That said, lots of people do want highly available masters. We have a tutorial how to do that out there, and we're making it much easier to implement.
There was a question about best practices. It's pretty broad. You try to narrow it down to best. I suggested to narrow it down to best practices around operations monitoring, but you have
it more towards the on-premises implementation for the unit.
For monitoring?
No, sorry. So what are the best practices for setting up an on-premises Kubernetes cluster?
Don't. On-premises is fine, and I know why people do it. If it's a really a greenfield thing, then I'd probably start with the cloud. That said, like I said before, we at Google, unlike some other clouds out there who remain nameless, strongly believe in hybrid. So,
what do we believe in?
Hybrid cloud. Okay. Very important for us. So.
For some companies, it's really important to know where their data is.
Yes, exactly. Data locality is a huge thing.
That's one main driver for setting up an on-premise.
Yeah, wow. So the best practice is try and get close to the cloud experience. Use things like VMware. Use manage groups inside VMware with defined pre-baked images for the nodes. There's a bunch of things like that. But it really is a setup. It's going to be a little bit of work at the beginning. But after that, it takes care of itself. The problem is that I talked about the managed instance groups, right? And so, we ran a test over there and hit 20 nodes, or 20 pods. Okay, this was a critical app. The first thing I want to do is get some more compute, right?
Yeah.
That's super, super easy in the cloud. On-premises, it's not as easy. It's easier if you use VMware or some virtualization layer. So that's a way to help at that. But you can never predict, ever predict how much load your application will take before it's running. I promise you, there are PhDs who embarrass PhDs at Google who have tried to solve this problem and failed every single time. You cannot. It's like an NP-hard problem. It is impossible to predict. And so, you're like, well, I got this little app, and all it does is use a button. How bad could it be? And then you spin up 20, and all of a sudden, you're out of compute. Right? it's just never possible to predict. And so what you really want is a way to expand that very flexibly, or, you know, some backhoe cut through a line, you want to move a bunch of things over to some other place. And so Kubernetes, in both those cases, are excellent for helping you do that, but you're going to have a rich infrastructure to make it smooth. Yeah.
How does it compare to other tools like
There's kind of a bunch of questions wrapped up in there. The question was, how does it compare to other services, Amazon ECS, and I assume you Swarm and Mesos and those things too, or no? Just the Amazon one. So Amazon has a service called ECS. I say this is a former Amazonian, so I don't know. Just giving you full disclosure. Amazon doesn't want to do hybrid cloud, which is a big fail because of situations like this, right? They will not release their cluster scheduler. What's that? Yeah. That's the way Amazon rolls. That's okay. We think we offer more in the box as it stands, right? So like, again, that list, the second slide I showed, of all the ways that you need to use, all the things you need to do to run Kubernetes in production. Take something basic like service discovery, right? You're gonna have to go out and get console and mount a console agent in every pod and then have it run a console server and be responsible for that and all that. Well, that's a lot of work. Kubernetes gives you that for free. How do you do log aggregation? How do you do monitoring? How do you do replication controllers? You know, all that great stuff. So we think we have a more complete solution for instantly getting ready to run at scale. That said, one of the most popular deployments of Kubernetes is on AWS. And we are hugely positive of that. And we don't know exactly what their numbers are, but we think it's like orders of magnitude more people are using Kubernetes on AWS than are using their own container.
In that situation, they're just installing Kubernetes. They're not using ECS, they're just installing
right.
Kubernetes on virtual machines on Amazon.
Right.
Just like they would do on-premise.
Yep.
Or like you can do on us. You can, if you would prefer
yeah.
not to use managed Kubernetes,
right.
like we offer GKE.
And
you
that
can install it on virtual machines on us.
That last point is probably the most important, right? Kubernetes is super stable, and we offer a 99.95 SLA on Kubernetes on Google. And we, like, I can't remember the last time a single person's cluster went down. Literally not one. It is super reliable. It's the easiest thing in the world. That said, we are planning to offer a number of new features in Kubernetes, or GKE, that are not specific to Kubernetes, that makes it run even better. I will say, though, so that is a reason to potentially use GKE. I will say, though, it is a core job of the project to support every possible cloud we can. And by the way, we take pull requests. I would love people to comment, say this was hard to use, say this was it's a core thing of the project to run on AWS and DigitalOcean and Rackspace and SoftLayer and so on and so forth.
Raspberry Pis.
So it is a core feature.
Maybe that's
even cool. If you're not ready to contribute code yourself, we would love for you to log in and say, hey, I tried to do this last night on whatever, DigitalOcean, and it failed. Why? Even that is helpful. And especially on AWS. We love those AWS customers. We want them continuing to use Kubernetes until the cows come.
Their GitHub repo is extremely active. The issues that are raised on it are often answered by the same Kubernetes engineers that we have in Warsaw and in Seattle, and the Red Hat engineers also. And a lot of people answer and solve those things on the GitHub repo. And I mentioned the Slack channel, slack.kubernetes.io. So both of those are really excellent places just to go give feedback when there's friction. And of course, the Stack Overflow on the sponsored channels are also monitored by our PC.
Yep.
Winding down, do we have any last ones before we do the clean? Oh, wow, I guess I was wrong.
Sorry, Kubernetes has what?
the document side, you clearly state Kubernetes is not a class.
Yes, correct.
And remove the statement.
Can I remove the second?
Only if I remove the statement. Your fix is closed.
Oh! No! We will never be a pass. Ever, ever, ever. Ever, 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 ever be a pass. Ever, 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 ever. There are great passes on top of Kubernetes. Use them. We, the Kubernetes team, have so much to do, so much vision for the future. Somebody else should provide the other functionality. We want to be a scheduler, we want to be an orchestrator, we want to help your containers run in production, keep them scaled, highly available. That's plenty. That's a full-time job. I'd say for cleaning up, to make sure you don't burn out your, I think you started 3 CPUs, which is going to be really damn cheap. You can probably run
the full 2 months of the project of the credits and not use your $300. But just in case, if you want to just wipe out everything and be really sure that you're never going to log into that console again and you don't want to get a 2-penny charge in your credit card in 2 months, go into the console to the project and basically click on Manage Projects or Home. There's a trash can button next to your project. Delete the project. You can wipe out the network resources, the storage, the cluster. If you think you're going to keep playing with it for a few days or in a month from now, maybe you want to keep the project around. Go into the container engine area and click the delete cluster. Is there a stop cluster? Can they stop it? I don't think so.
Delete it.
Click delete cluster, but you saw it only took you 2 minutes to create a cluster when you clicked that button. So click delete cluster. And it also created some network load balancing rules for your cluster. I'm not confident that those get deleted when you turn off the cluster.
I'm fairly sure they do.
Okay, we're fairly sure they do, but you might want to check if you search for network.
But to be clear, you won't be charged. You don't get charged for network.
Well, the network load balancing we had this for static IPs anyway. The small. Yeah, I got static. Yeah. Okay. Probably won't get charged, but yeah.
You pay for
1 month.
You pay for 1 month.
No, no. For the VMs that we start, you pay per minute. So, okay, hey, good. Get the sales in here. Let's talk about pricing. Resources, like people are always saying, cloud needs to pay for what you use. And apparently they're full of crap, because I often hear people ask questions like, oh, so I put some storage in and I need to pay for that storage for the whole month, right? Or I run some machines, I need to pay for that for the whole month. No, the storage is per byte per second, so as soon as you delete a storage thing, it's done. Persistent disks, you pay for the size of the disk per second, not the storage. But the virtual machines are, you pay per minute. There's a 10-minute minimum because of starting times, but basically, if you run the machine for 25 minutes and turn it off, you pay for 25 minutes and not even in full out. So that's a really important pricing differentiator, especially if you're doing scaling workloads. But I will also say, when you delete the cluster, also check the networking section to make sure there's not networking load balancing stuff. There might be a persistent disk failure, but we're pretty sure that deleting the cluster wipes out all that.
To be honest, deleting the project is fine. Because you're still gonna have login, you're still gonna have your credits on your account and things like that. You're just deleting the project.
Yeah, that's a good point. So to say that to the speaker, microphone again. Deleting your project is just fine, because if you want, you just create a new project. You still keep those credits. Those credits are valid for 2 months, and they expire after 2 months. You can use them faster if you want. I won't complain.
Yeah, go bit and online or something.
Otherwise, create a new Google account.
Yeah, exactly. Create a new Google account. It's a new project. Cool. Any questions about that deleting project or anything? Just email me. You get a $500 bill, or get a $2,000 bill. In a month, figure it out. So actually, we'll look at the log and figure out what we started.
Yeah,
don't start off 3,000 again. Cool. So, guys, I guess we're going to wrap up. I want to thank Software Circus for hosting and helping us get the space, and the Runner and I gang for taking care of this.
and Dave's busy chatting. So, how about a round of applause for Dave, since I think Dave's